Welcome to Common Hour. My name is Jim Strick, and I'm the chair of the program in Science, Technology, and Society, and a professor of environmental studies. I'd like to introduce our ASL interpreter, Emily Phipps. Thank you, Emily, for interpreting for us today. Please note that if you need to change your screen view to watch Emily as you're watching Common Hour, you can adjust the screen display mode in the small box labeled View towards the upper right of the Zoom window. You can also enable the closed captioning CC at the bottom if you like. A very warm welcome to all to our fifth Common Hour of the semester. Common Hour is a unique and inclusive program that brings the Franklin and Marshall community together weekly during the academic year for culturally and intellectually enriching events. It's the only regularly scheduled event that unites faculty, students, and staff and invites the larger community to join us. Throughout the pandemic, the Common Hour has continued to provide a virtual gathering space and a source of inspiration, education, and compelling discussion for the FNM community and beyond. We hope you'll join us during the Common Hour after spring break, which is our next one, March 24th, for Tato Enriquez speaking about Cosmico, a journey through Latin American music. Please follow Common Hour on our webpage, the Presence Events calendar, and our FNM Common Hour Instagram page. During today's event, Zoom viewers can submit questions for our speaker via the Q&A feature. Please indicate your affiliation with the college, but we do not need your name. Now, I'd like to introduce Ahmed Abukwek, a senior economics major and co-proposer of today's event, who will introduce our speaker. Ahmed?
Hi, everyone, students, professors, community members. Today, we have Gidon Bromberg, who is co-founder and Israeli director of EcoPeace Middle East, a regional organization started in 1994 that brings together Jordanian, Palestinian, and Israeli environmentalists to promote sustainable development. He has spearheaded the advocacy campaigns of the organizations both in Israel and internationally and developed the cross-border community building program, Good Water Neighbors. Gidon speaks regularly on water, peace, and security issues, including before the UN Security Council, Climate Summit, Munich Security Conference, at the UN Commission for Sustainable Development, the U.S. House of Representatives, and the European Parliament. Gidon was named an environmental hero by Time magazine, and he most recently received Stanford Law School Bright Award for the environment, and with his co-directors awarded the Skoll Award for Social Entrepreneurship. Please join me in welcoming Gidon Bromberg.
So thank you very much, Ahmed, for those kind words, for that introduction. And thank you to the Franklin and Marshall School for inviting me to present before you today. I'm truly honored to, and I'm always excited to speak before a student audience in particular, because my founding of EcoPeace Middle East, or co-founding of EcoPeace Middle East, was based on a research paper that I wrote while doing a master's in international environmental law at American University back in 1993-94. And I asked the question, like many of you students do, for my research. And at that time, I asked the question, was peace going to be good, Middle East peace, for the environment? And my research concluded that environmental issues were really not on the agenda. They were just being given a little bit of lip service. And one of the recommendations of my research was that perhaps if a civil society organization that brings together Palestinian, Jordanian, and Israeli environmentalists, if we come together and create a new organization, the very first organization ever that would involve nationals from our three peoples, perhaps we would succeed to make sure that the peace that we thought was breaking out would not only be peace between people, but also peace with nature. Sadly, the peace process that we were so excited about hasn't brought the results yet that we wanted. And EcoPeace, since then, since 94, in fact, remains, sadly, the only organization that exists in any field that brings together Palestinians, Jordanians, and Israelis. Our organization works out of three offices. I'm located in Tel Aviv in Israel. Our Palestinian director is in Ramallah in Palestine, and our Jordanian director is in Amman in Jordan. And we're about 70 staff in total, roughly a third each. What I want to speak about today is our efforts really to advance climate resilience in our region, and particularly water and energy security. And the presentation that I'm about to give is really based on more than two decades of our work. This presentation highlights a report that we released in December 2020, so just over a year ago, that calls for a Green Blue Deal for the Middle East. And it's very much inspired by the European Green Deal for climate resilience for that continent, and the efforts of the Biden administration to really fight the climate crisis. And you can see at the conference where we opened, where we released this report, we had some very high level participants, Her Royal Highness Princess Esmeralda of Belgium, and the Foreign Minister of Finland, His Excellency Pekka Haavisto, but also the former American ambassador to Israel and the EU special envoy, and Israeli, Palestinian, and Jordanian government officials. And to understand the background as to what we're dealing with, we need to understand that the North Africa and the Middle East, the MENA region, where we live, Israel is here on the Mediterranean coast, and Gaza and the West Bank is right next to us, and Jordan also. We're the most water insecure part of the world, and we have less precipitation per person than any other part of the planet. And sadly, we're also an area that is heavily conflictual. There are many conflicts in our region, not just the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, as you can see from this map. And one of the underlying reasons for many of the conflicts, not all, and often not the main reason, but an underlying contributory cause to many of the conflicts, is fed by the water insecurity that we face. And then when we look at the climate crisis that is approaching us, then there's great reason for much further concern, because while the latest IPCC report talks about the importance of limiting temperature increase to 1.5 degrees Celsius beyond current standards or current temperatures. Here in the Eastern Mediterranean, since the 1950s, we've already experienced close to a 2 degree increase in temperature in Celsius. And we are forecasting, or the different climate models are forecasting anywhere between a 4 to 7 degree additional increase in temperatures. By the middle of the century, you can see at the moment there is precipitation during the autumn periods. By the middle of the century, we're going to see no rain whatsoever in the autumn months. By the end of the century, the models are telling us that we can expect a 50% increase in the summer months. Now, for any of you that have been to the Middle East, the Eastern Mediterranean, you might know that quite naturally it doesn't rain for anywhere 5-6 months of the year, and that's natural. But we're now going to see 9, perhaps even 10 months of the year without rainfall. And when it does rain, we're already seeing it rains cats and dogs. It leads to floods. It doesn't contribute sufficiently to aquifer recharge, and it's mostly runoff either to the Mediterranean, to the west, or to the Jordan River, to the east. And you know, given I love this map because it'll confuse you all, because it's not a political map; it's a watershed map of our region. And you would otherwise see the West Bank here, and Israel here, and Gaza here. Well, when we look at our shared watersheds, it just highlights how the political borders don't count when it comes to having to build resilience to meet the challenge of flood events during the climate crisis is one. Ramallah, the major sort of city in the West Bank is on this side of the what in Hebrew we'd call the Yarkon watershed, and Tel Aviv, where I am, is here, and it's the same watershed. And if we don't learn how to manage each one of these watersheds, including between Israel and Jordan, where the watersheds also just make a mockery of all of the political borders, then we're simply not going to survive well. And when we again look at the models, if any of you have been to the Gulf states in summer, it's quite unbearable to be outside. And our region here in the Eastern Mediterranean, by the end of the century, will be 9 months of the year unbearable, similar to the worst days in the Gulf. And on those worst days, it's a health hazard to do any physical work outside. It's just simply too hot for the body to survive in physical labor under such heat. Another example, this is not due to climate change, but another example of how interconnected we are is this satellite image that at EcoPeace we obtained, highlighting when a neighbor fails. This is an example of sewage not being treated. And it's due to conflict regions, it's due to management reasons, it's due to economic reasons, but it doesn't really matter why. In the end, when sewage is not treated, and this is organic matter, this is the sewage on the land, that it's released out to the sea. And it doesn't just, of course, stay on the coast of one side. This is the Gaza coast of the Palestinian territories. And from here, it's the Israeli coast. And you can see that the sewage is simply carried by the currents, not only to Gaza's beaches and threatening life on the Gaza side, but also on the Israeli side. And just here north of Gaza in Israel, there's a city called Ashkelon, where there's one of five of Israel's desalination plants. And I'll go into how important these desalination plants are later, but the sewage leads to the intermittent closure of this Ashkelon desalination plant, which is responsible today for 15% of the drinking water of the country of Israel. So that these cross-border issues and a failure on one side always leads to failures on the other side. And this is what we need to avoid, these lose-lose scenarios as the climate crisis progresses. And then that requires us to be thinking out of the box. And our proposition at EcoPeace is that the climate crisis is not just a threat multiplier, which is what it's generally seen, that things are just going to get worse. And if there's conflict, there'll just be more conflict because water resources will be even more scarce. Well, no, we're moving forward a proposition that the opposite can be the case. It's dependent on us. And the climate crisis can be an opportunity for cooperation. We have four propositions on the table that I will present. The first one, of a win-win scenario, is looking at the experience of Europe after World War II. I mean, here, we are at this time with the Russian invasion of Ukraine, which is threatening global stability. But, just 70 years ago, the world was in complete tatters. And after World War II, the U.S., really imposed or help advance a coal and steel arrangement between primarily France, Germany, Italy, and then other European countries joined to make sure that war would be unimaginable. And you know, coal and steel were the engines of the economy. They're also the engine of the war machine. And the coal and steel agreement forced cooperation so that war would be unimaginable. So at EcoPeace, we thought deeply what might be relevant to our region, and particularly to our three countries, Israel, Palestine, and Jordan, as to how could we create healthy interdependencies like the coal and steel agreement created for Europe. And our research back in 2017 showed that, that the coal and the steel that's relevant to our part of the world is harnessing the sun, mostly through renewables, as you see here, and harnessing the sea through desalinating Mediterranean seawater and turning it into drinking water. And in that way, we can produce region-wide water security and energy security for all of our countries. And our research showed that Jordan has the comparative advantage in our part of the world, at least compared to Israel and Palestine, to produce renewable electricity at scale and at prices that that Israelis and Palestinians can't match. And that's because of a vast desert. It's a large country compared to the rest of the region and has vast desert areas with a high plateau, which makes it perfect for renewable energy production. Now, you know, if you look on the map, Israel has the Negev. Some of you might have been here, but the Negev is captured. Half the Negev is military training areas, the other half are declared nature reserves. Israel is struggling to meet its climate commitments of 30% renewables by 2030 or 100% renewables by 2050, mostly because of the difficulty to find land. And Israel's at around 9% renewables. And Israel's commitment to the Paris Accords and then this last conference of the parties in Glasgow increased Israel's commitment from an earlier 17% to 30% by the end of this decade, that allowed us to work with the government of Israel to highlight that Israel will not be able to meet its climate commitments without purchasing renewable electricity from renewable sources from either neighboring Jordan or Egypt. On the other hand, the Mediterranean coast, both of Israel and potentially also of Gaza, have the comparative advantage in that the Mediterranean is no more than 100 kilometers from all of the major cities, Israeli, Palestinian, or Jordanian. It's 100 kilometers. Amman, the capital of Jordan, is somewhere here. It's 100 kilometers from Tel Aviv to Amman. It's also 100 kilometers from Irbid, the second largest city in Jordan here, to the Mediterranean. Jordan has a sea, the Gulf of Aqaba, but it's 300 kilometers to Amman, 400 kilometers to Irbid. That means double or triple the cost of water because water is heavy and it's expensive to move. So what we highlighted is that Israelis and Palestinians could be producing large-scale desalinated water to gain water security for all of our three countries, so that the 40% reduction in precipitation that is forecasted would not die us all off of thirst, because we can replace the loss of natural water with desalinated water, and that we could power the desalinated water the desalination facilities with solar energy coming from Jordan, and achieve, as I said earlier, region-wide water security, region-wide energy security, and for the very first time promote regional integration and regional stability, because each side would have something to buy and each side would have something to sell. Well, late last year, our vision became a reality, at least between Israel and Jordan. And some of you might have seen in the press that Israel, Jordan, together with the UAE and under the auspices of Secretary Kerry from the United States, an actual declaration of intent, completely based on the EcoPeace concept, was agreed to. We'd originally also agreed to include the Palestinians from the outset, but that didn't happen, mostly because Jordan and the West Bank are already selling electricity, so there was no precedent here. And the political situation in Gaza makes it still very difficult to build a large-scale desalination plant. But nevertheless, here in the south of Jordan, major investments are currently being considered, over a giga of electricity. Solar electricity would be produced here in the south, and then a dedicated line would move the electricity to the north, across to Israel, and then connect to the Israeli network, enabling Israel to meet her water requirements at cheapest, her energy commitments to Paris at cheapest prices. And on the other hand, Jordan would either siphon, would purchase some of the water currently produced. These blue dots are existing desalination plants in Israel. Each one of them is, you know, anywhere between 120 to 200 million cubic meters of water. Currently, these five blue existing desalination plants are producing over 70% of the drinking water that Israelis consume, of the domestic water, with some additional large desalination plants coming on board within a few years here in the north of Israel, and some further expansion here in the center. Out of this deal struck between Israel and Jordan, Jordan is seeking to build, or have built on her behalf, a desalination plant here somewhere in the north, to be connected to Israel's national water carrier, and water moved to the Sea of Galilee and then supplied across to Jordan. This is the cheapest way for Jordan to meet its climate challenges and its water security challenges. Again, you know, depending on those that might have been to the region, but Israel is the only country that has 24/7 water supply. In Amman, Jordan's capital, water is supplied for just 8 hours a week because of a lack of water. Every house has a canister on its roof, or you're storing water under the house. And when the municipality supplies the water for those 8 hours, our staff might not come to work, because that's the day that you need to do your washing, your cleaning, as much watering perhaps as you need for your crops or for your garden. And then, you know, during those 8 hours, the tanks are filled, and then you need to really conserve water until the next week when water is supplied again. So you might not be able to shower every day, certainly if you have a large family. No one dies of thirst, but you can purchase water from tankers, but that can be at double or triple the cost of municipal water, and that's very expensive for most people. I'll come and describe also the situation in the West Bank and Gaza a little bit later on. So the actual deal struck between Israel and Jordan will now enable water to move at very large quantities, 200 million initially, probably 400 million in stage two. And at EcoPeace, what we're proposing is that instead of the water would be flowing, you know, from the Sea of Galilee, which is the northern part of Israel, by pipe, and this is a small pipe crossing the border. The Yarmouk River, which flows into the Jordan, is the border between Israel and Jordan in this area. And currently the water is supplied by pipe to another open canal that runs parallel to the River Jordan. And then the water is piped up again to Amman. Now, at EcoPeace, the second opportunity that we see coming out of the water energy deal is to rehabilitate the River Jordan. And the river would naturally flow out of the Sea of Galilee and come to the terminal lake, which is the Dead Sea. These are all, of course, famous bodies of water. You know, this is where in Christian tradition, Jesus walks on the lake and miracles happen in the River Jordan under Judaism, under Christianity, and four of the companions to the Prophet Muhammad are buried on the Jordanian side, on the eastern bank of the Jordan River, despite the fact that this river is so holy to half of humanity, to the three Abrahamic traditions. The conflict and water scarcity really turned the river into little more than a sewage canal, with Israel stopping basically all clean water leaving from the Sea of Galilee, and then Syria and Jordan stopping the flow on the Yarmouk and then every side tributary. So that what has been flowing and what sadly flows today in the Jordan River is mostly sewage, a lot of it from Jordanian and Palestinian communities, agricultural runoff and fish farm waste, a lot of it coming from Israel. And it's only about 5% of the historical flow. So with water moving west, now desalinated water to move west in order to supply water to Jordan's capital and Jordan's population, we see the opportunity to remove the sewage. And rather than using pipes and canals, in fact, USAID built this canal, based on the Tennessee Valley experience in the US. We're coming and saying, well, let's use the natural river as the regional water supply and have water flow down the Jordan, desalinated water mixed with natural water in the Sea of Galilee, and provide water to both Palestinian populations and predominantly to very thirsty Amman. But by taking the water out of the river as close as to the Dead Sea as possible so that we can rehabilitate. And here you can see a more rehabilitated Jordan River as a result. And in that way, we create further economic opportunities. Just like the water energy deal creates a new set of economic opportunities for Israel and Jordan, the rehabilitation of the Jordan River creates a new set of economic opportunities for Palestinian, Jordanian, and Israeli communities along the river, who, and this is what the Jordan Valley sort of looks like, and some historical, it's a 2,000-year-old Roman bridge across the River Jordan, another site of the river in a cleaner area before the sewage starts to flow. But we need to diversify income sources in the Jordan Valley because of the climate crisis, there's less and less rain. And therefore there's less and less agriculture, and a healthy river would help transform the valley from a valley of its current state of poverty of only about $4 billion annually to an economy, to a valley of shared prosperity of up to $73 billion. And much of that is due to the fact that the river is holy to half of humanity, and instead of attracting only about 1 million pilgrims a year at the moment, it potentially could attract 10, 20, 50 million tourists a year and create a whole new set of economic opportunities for the residents. The third pillar of the Green Blue Deal that I want to present is focused very much so on the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, and particularly on advancing the water issues, water resilience between Israelis and Palestinians. And here I need to go back a little bit into the history, because the Oslo Accords, which is the agreement that was signed between the State of Israel and the PLO in 94 and 95, was based on a interim agreement. It wasn't a peace treaty, unlike Israel and Jordan that in 94 signed a peace treaty. Israel and the PLO signed an interim agreement. And they signed an interim agreement because there were hard issues that they felt were still too hard to solve. Issues such as how to share Jerusalem, the issue of return or potential return of Palestinian refugees? Where would they come back to? Would they come back to what would be the new state of Palestine or to the state of Israel? Security issues, hard still to resolve. And the fifth issue, which was hard to resolve, was water. And that's because at that time in 1995, desalination wasn't developed here. We only saw it in the Gulf because the cost of desalination was so expensive. It was about $2, $2 a cubic meter to produce 1,000 liters of water. Today, the cost of desalination is down to 40 cents, which is far more comparable to the cost of natural water. But in 95, when the Oslo Accords were negotiated, there was only these three water bodies: the coastal aquifer shared between Gaza and Israel, the mountain aquifer shared between the West Bank and Israel, and of course the Jordan River system. And any attempt to move to more fairly share these natural water resources, because the fact is that in 94, 95, Israel was in control and benefiting from the lion's share, about 80% of the shared waters, particularly of this mountain aquifer, which is the best quality water in the region. And the Palestinians were only getting access to 20%, partly due to the fact that the springs of the mountain aquifer fall on the coastal plain or in the coastal areas, which are in Israel, and less in the mountain areas, which are in the West Bank. But nevertheless, there was an agreement reached that in principle, the peace treaty that would be signed within 5 years between Israelis and Palestinians would satisfy and move to meet Palestinian water rights. Now, the Oslo Accords simply allocated a little bit more water. So the Palestinian access rose to 25% and the Israeli access was reduced to 75%. The idea was a deal would be struck. Israel would be so-called generous on sharing water, more water with the Palestinians, while the Palestinians would be so-called more generous on the issue of refugees, how many Palestinian refugees would actually come back to Israel proper. Sadly, as we all know, no agreement was reached within those 5 years and even until today. And we're still left with that same allocation of natural water. Palestinians are buying somewhat more desalinated water from Israel, but nevertheless, the water scarcity situation in the West Bank is quite similar to the water scarcity situation today in Jordan. But the reason as to why water was put aside as a hard issue to solve is no longer relevant today, and that's much due to Israel's leadership in the desalination sector on the one hand, but also in leadership in treating sewage. So Israel is the world leader in treating sewage and reusing it for agriculture. About half the agriculture in Israel is today grown with treated wastewater, and it constitutes more water than what was ever allocated from the Sea of Galilee, as an example. So the water pie has tremendously increased, yet at EcoPeace, we describe water issues being held hostage to the conflict. And they're being held hostage because the paradigm as to how to move forward on a peace agreement between Israelis and Palestinians has been set as an all or nothing paradigm. Either agreement is reached on all five final status issues, with water being one of them, or no agreement is reached on anything. Because of that paradigm, the water issue hasn't moved forward. So we're the major advocate to move forward today, that under the climate crisis, we can't continue to hold water issues hostage, which means a declining access to groundwater for the Palestinians, a declining quantity of water for Palestinian agriculture, and we try to speak to the self-interest of both sides by saying that, by meeting Palestinian water needs as a Palestinian interest, but also and making sure that there is a more vibrant economy on the Palestinian side is also an Israeli security interest, because otherwise we'll see more and more instability on the Palestinian side, as we would see also on the Jordanian side if the water energy exchange probably didn't move forward. So there's no reason to continue to see this situation. This is a typical water tank. This is a tank on a Palestinian school in the West Bank. This is a Bedouin village that are having their tanks refilled by water tankers. In Gaza, the situation is so severe that you can't even access the groundwater anymore. It's so over-pumped. You know, Gaza was not meant to have 2 million people, 40 kilometers by 10 in size. And the small desalination plants that exist there are providing the drinking and cooking water that the population uses. So, you know, the population in Gaza has really gone back to the Middle Ages, where they can't even utilize the tap water that they have. And this is an intolerable situation that is solvable. And what it requires is, both the government of Israel, but also the Palestinian Authority to come and say, let's move forward on water first. Not because we don't want to give up on, reaching a agreement on the other issues, but that the climate crisis doesn't allow us to continue to wait, that there's an urgency here. And like the water energy concept that we advanced, we're seeing more and more political leaders on the Israeli side and on the Palestinian side being more open to moving forward on water issues. We also see this as a way to keep the two-state solution alive, to bring a little bit of hope to our troubled region, because the all or nothing approach has for the last 27 years left both peoples with a strong sense that there's no hope that there'll ever be peace, because nothing has ever moved forward. But that's partly because the paradigm hasn't allowed anything to move forward. And the political paradigm has been, sort of made by us, made by people. There's no reason why we can't change it. A second aspect of the water issue is also the sewage issue, because on the Palestinian side, sewage is not being properly treated, partly due to conflict issues, but also partly due to internal Palestinian management issues and lack of finance. And this leads to cross-border pollution issues. All of these streams cross from the West Bank, from Palestinian communities into Israeli communities. And it's really a continuation of a lose-lose, where the most water-scarce part of the world is polluting the scarce natural water resources that it has in such low quantities. Another important aspect for cooperation to meet the climate challenge is also flood control. This is Gaza City. And we're seeing now every winter that the streets of Gaza are flooded. They're flooded because of a lack of investments in infrastructure, but also because the watershed that would otherwise, that brings all the water into Gaza is either in Israel or the West Bank. And without cooperation, without what we're suggesting here, is to put in an early warning flood system where people can be alerted well in advance and move away from flood zones that we increasingly see every winter, so that life is protected on both sides. And this is another easy measure of cooperation that would make a real difference. The fourth and final chapter that I'll speak about is the education element. So at EcoPeace, we've been leading a program called Good Water Neighbors for more than 20 years. And the Good Water Neighbors program is built is coined on the basis of instead of good fences make good neighbors, good water can make good neighbors. And here you see youth water trustees, Palestinian, Jordanian, and Israeli together. They're learning water diplomacy issues. They're learning about their water reality and their neighbor's water reality and the interconnection of the two, both on the fresh water and on the sanitation issues. They learn separately through their school systems, but then we bring a cadre of youth leaders, and we like to call them, you know, sort of like the Greta Thornbergs that are Palestinian, Jordanian, and Israeli, and they come together to meet each other, to talk about the climate crisis, the transboundary water issues, and to try to promote solutions, calling on, in this case, their mayors. So this is a clean stretch of the Jordan River. It's one of my favorite photos because these are the mayors of the Jordan River. It's not a pretty sight. There's some big bellies here, but these are Palestinian, Jordanian, and Israeli mayors. And they're jumping into the river here, not because they're best friends. They're not. There's a lot of animosity and hate and violence in our region, unfortunately. But these mayors, much due to the activities of the youth in their community, have come to understand that they're all losers because the youth are leading the efforts, calling on them to work together, not to do a favor to the other side, but for the benefit of their own community. The water resources are shared. If we're going to rehabilitate the Jordan River, one side cannot do it alone. It requires all sides. And only when all sides work together can we gain the economic benefits of a rehabilitated river, bring back 50% of the biodiversity that we lost because of the demise of this river, but also create new job opportunities and income, which is desperately needed for so many of these residents. And we've modeled, this is a guest house that EcoPeace operates in Jordan. We've modeled how we can bring nature back and also bring revenue for the local community by building what we call this Jordan Eco Park on or near the banks of the Jordan River on the Jordanian side. And this is also a school in Gaza that we turned into a model school, collecting rainwater, using solar renewable energy for its electricity, a gray water reuse system, and of course, introducing a curriculum on water diplomacy. In fact, in Israeli high schools, the water diplomacy program is now officially part of an elective. And as far as we understand, this is the first occasion in the world where high schools are officially learning water diplomacy. And this is what we need to now scale up. We need to make sure that it's not just, you know, the schools that EcoPeace are working in Israel, Jordan, and Palestine. This needs to be mainstreamed so that all of our young people can focus their energies on something very positive that leads to cooperation and leads to climate resilience. Finally, it's my last slide. Ahmed said, we've managed to bring this issue to the highest levels. This is Nada Majdalani, the Palestinian director of EcoPeace, Yana, the Jordanian, myself, together with the then president of the UN Security Council. We're in New York, and we're invited by the German government under 3 years ago to present this work, even before the Green-Blue Deal was published. And we were invited again earlier this year, for the second time in less than 3 years, this time indeed to present. We're invited this time by the Norwegian president of the Security Council to present the Green Blue Deal as a model for climate resilience, not only for the Middle East, but globally. And we've created champions. This is the foreign minister of Finland who spoke at the conference. Who's really leading the call and trying to attract other foreign ministers from around the world to help gain political support so that our governments in Israel, in Jordan, and in Palestine adopt all of the four and even additional measures that can build climate resilience that is so desperately needed in our region. So I'm going to leave it there, and I look forward to any questions that that you might have, or further clarifications or comments. So is it back to you, Ahmed, or is it Jim?
Yeah, I'm fielding the questions. Thanks so much. Great talk. We got several questions at this point. I'll just lead off with them in the order they've come in. The first is an anonymous question that says, human rights organizations often report Israel's confiscation of internationally funded water pipes and water projects in the West Bank while constructing swimming pools in the Israeli settlements. What has your organization, EcoPeace, done to address Israel's policies that systematically restrict water resources from Palestinian communities in the West Bank in favor of illegal Israeli settlements?
So clearly a tough question and a good question. So at EcoPeace, you know, we're calling for a fair sharing of natural waters between Israelis and Palestinians, as I highlighted. And the reason that that, you know, the Israeli military can confiscate you know, pipes in Area C, which is what happens, 60% of the West Bank, is because both parties are still in the mindset of an all or nothing approach. You know, our call is that the government of Israel and the Palestinian Authority agree to advancing water issues and reaching an agreement on how to share fairly the natural water. And, you know, it takes two to tango. This is going to require both the government of Israel and the Palestinian Authority. If I can tell you a little bit of story, you know, I actually was involved in the discussions and met with the respective negotiators on the Israeli side and on the Palestinian side. And on the Israeli side, the negotiator at the time said, look, you know, yes, I understand Israel can afford to be more generous on water, but in the eyes of the Israeli public, you know, I'll look bad, and because I'd look like I'm being generous in giving something without getting something in return. And therefore, you know, Gidon, you know, help me move forward not only on water, but also on refugees. And on the Palestinian side, I was told, well, Gidon, you know, I understand, you know, moving forward on water would mean more water in every Palestinian home, but that would reduce the pressure that Israel is under. And I'm worried that if Israel's under less pressure, then it won't move forward on the other critical issues that I want to see move forward, you know, Jerusalem and the Palestinian state. So, you know, let's move forward on water, but also let's also condition it to borders. And EcoPeace, of course, wasn't able to advance refugees and not final status border issues. And we think that's a mistake on both sides. And that's really the role here that the international community can play. And Secretary Kerry and Secretary Blinken could play from the US government to help the parties move forward. It's also the international community has never publicly said that it supports a water first or the all or nothing approach. It's time, because of the climate crisis, because of human rights issues, to move forward on water first.
Okay. the next question, also anonymous, says, the energy deal between the Emirates, Israel, and Jordan cut out Palestinians. What does your organization make of that?
So that's not true. We were heavily involved. I mean, the whole idea comes from EcoPeace. Our Palestinian director sought to involve the Palestinian Authority right from the outset. But also, as I said in the presentation, an electricity connection has existed for over a decade between Jordan and Palestine, between Jordan and the city of Jericho in the West Bank. And the Palestinian Authority, you know, said, well, we're already connected to Jordan. And, you know, we don't need the assistance of EcoPeace to further expand that. In fact, you know, there's an agreement to expand the energy sale from Jordan to Palestine, and even to build a transmission line up to Ramallah. We think that there's a missed opportunity, that the electricity currently being sold from Jordan to the West Bank is just regular electricity, which is only 20% renewable in Jordan. And we still think that the Palestinian Authority and Jordan should move forward on a much larger electricity deal that would be all renewable rather than mostly fossil. So, you know, Palestine was not excluded from this deal. Simply, the existing arrangement between Jordan and Israel was seen as something that doesn't require further support from others like EcoPeace to advance.
We have a question from a staff member, and maybe this is particularly pertinent to your suggestion just now that Jordan could expand its renewable generation. How are these initiatives being funded? I mean, if Jordan was to, for example, dramatically expand renewable generation, where's the money for that coming from?
So the beauty of both the water and energy side is that it's all private sector led. That the investments that are taking place in Jordan are not through donor assistance, they're not grants. You know, the UAE is investing here through one of its companies in a profitable endeavor, because in these last years, we've seen the cost of renewable energy literally plummet. And in our part of the world, in a sunny part of the world, daytime electricity is cheapest through the sun. It's cheaper than any fossil fuel. And with the advancement in battery technology, even including storage is still cheaper than coal, oil, or gas. So that the solar is being funded as a profitable project by the private sector. In this case, it's going to be UAE finance, but the other solar projects in Jordan are all private sector led, and Jordan has the capacity. In fact, the fascinating thing is that the whole Saudi Peninsula, Jordan, Saudi Arabia, Iraq, down to the Gulf, they all can become major producers of renewable energy because we have the desert and 360 days of sun. And today the technology exists to move that electricity, to move the electricity produced by the sun either west to Europe. And the opportunity exists because Israel is connecting through an underwater electricity line to Cyprus, and then Cyprus is being connected to mainland Europe. Well, we can just scale that up to move, just like Morocco is selling electricity, solar electricity, to Spain and then onto Europe, then the connection from Israel to Cyprus can be a major supply of renewables to Europe, as can from Egypt to Crete and then onto mainland Europe. And this is all a profitable business that can replace the loss of revenue that needs to take place from the oil producing countries as commitments further rise. And for the climate crisis. Similarly, on the desalination. So Israel has five of the 10 largest desalination plants in the world. All of it are built by the private sector. And that's because the cost of desalination has plummeted to such a degree that it's a profitable exercise. So, if the desalination is powered by renewables, then also the ecological issues are at least reduced. There are some others, but I can expand on that if there are some questions. You're on mute, Jim.
Sorry, you'd think by now we would have learned, right? there are a couple of questions actually about desalination. I'll start with the first one. It seems that Israel blocks Palestinians from building desalination plants. Is your deal feasible with Israeli government policy?
So the government of Israel doesn't is not against desalination plants in Gaza. On the contrary, it's actually a publicly stated position that Israel wants to see large desalination facilities built in Gaza. And that's for selfish reasons, that the water insecurity in Gaza is an underlying security threat for Israel. It's an issue that leads to more and more instability. You know, there's no, on all sides here, there's no generosity. People act in quite a narrow self-interest, and the continuing water crisis in Jordan is not only an issue of instability, it's also an issue of potential health issues. You know, as people are drinking unhealthy water, you know, as we see from COVID, there's greater chances of other pandemic diseases breaking out, and those diseases don't stop at a border. You know, they're carried with the sewage, as you saw, moving up the Mediterranean or on land sources or through the groundwater. So no one has an interest. The failure to build a large desalination plant in Gaza is complicated. It's very much due to the conflict, but there's lots of conflicts here in place. There's a conflict between Hamas that rules Gaza and the Palestinian Authority in Ramallah don't see eye to eye, and that's an impediment. There's the cost, because who's going to pay the cost of building the desalination plant and perhaps more importantly, of operating the desalination plant, because poverty levels are so high in Gaza that the population would struggle to pay the full cost. So while the international community is willing to pay the capital cost of building the desalination plant, no one is coming and saying that they're going to subsidize it forever. So that's another major impediment. And then there is a request by the international community that Israel would guarantee not to bomb a desalination plant if there's a war between Hamas and Israel. And Israel refuses to give such a letter, stating that if rockets are launched at Israel from a position right next to the desalination plant, then those rockets will be attacked in response. So the situation is more complicated than perhaps the individual who asked the question.
And another question from a faculty member: can you tell us a little bit about the technology that has made desalination as cost and energy efficient as it seems to have become?
So I'm a lawyer by training rather than an engineer, but the technology is reverse osmosis. And what's happening is that the seawater is being pumped at incredibly high pressure through membranes that allow the water to flow through, but all of the salts and minerals remain behind. And that technology is highly efficient, and there's a whole set of additional energy, capturing of energy through the process that reduces the need for higher levels of energy in the past. And that's really led to the drop. So all the technology was more about precipitating, heating the water and then capturing the steam that becomes drinking water. That was a very energy intensive engineering process using reverse osmosis membrane technology. Has seen the dramatic cost drop in water. And there's even more technology coming on board, hopefully, called forward osmosis, which could see the cost of desalination drop by perhaps even 50%, and then it would be completely comparable to fresh water, to natural water, because natural water also costs money. I mean, you need to pump it out of the ground, you need to filter it. So the cheapest natural water in our part of the world is about 20 cents a cubic meter, and if forward osmosis technology would move forward at scale, then that could be even cheaper than natural water. The problem with desalination, in addition to its energy, and if the energy is renewable, then that's no longer a problem, is the release of the brine. Because at the moment, the salts that are taken out of the water are sent back to the ocean, but in much higher quantities and concentrations, which, of course, high concentrations of salt impact biodiversity. Now, you know, if it was just one desalination plant, that probably wouldn't be such an issue. But Israel is planning to build 10, and Cyprus is building on its side, and Syria and Lebanon and Egypt and Palestine, everyone, Greece, the whole Eastern Mediterranean, and North Africa will have to continue to build more and more desalination plants. And the accumulated impact of all of that brine needs to be of great concern. And here again, you know, some technological solutions are being researched to utilize the brine as an alternative to cement, and to turn the salt into building blocks. And there is a company in Israel that is leading that effort. If it becomes profitable, then the brine will have a market, and then it will no longer just be dumped as a waste, but it'll be utilized, and that way we reduce another significant impact of desalination. I still say, however, that desalination always needs to be the last choice, not the first choice. We first of all need to get the price of water right. And in many parts of the world, water is either free or heavily subsidized. Certainly doesn't reflect its true value and its scarcity. So first of all, and one of the reasons why Israel is a world leader on water issues is the cost of water is high. The price is right. The price reflects scarcity. And that means that investing in technology that conserves water, that introduces drip irrigation systems for agriculture, that can reduce the water consumed for farming by over 90%, or utilizing treated wastewater. It's because it's in areas where the treated wastewater is cheaper than the fresh water that you see success. Farmers will always look for cheaper water. And if treated wastewater is cheaper than fresh water, then they'll demand it. And that's why in Israel, it's half the agriculture is today treated wastewater. For areas of the southwest of the US, where you also face increasingly difficult climatic conditions, that has to be part of your solution too. Dealing with water loss. Amman gets water 8 hours a week in Jordan, but half the water that it gets is lost through either leaking pipes or water theft. And that's very common. I know the city like New York loses 40% of its water just because the system is not properly and maintained. So there's, desalination should only come into place really when we're conserving and we're utilizing and we're valuing water as it should. And then in areas like ours where, without desalination, people would literally go thirsty. That's when you start introducing that technology.
Well, thanks so much. We have more questions, but I'm afraid we're out of time for today. It's a really interesting presentation. And I mean, obviously your group is working against a very difficult political situation, and political stability would help everything move further forward. But we really thank you for a fascinating and detailed presentation.
So I'm delighted to have been given this opportunity. I'm putting on, let me tell you our website, ecopeaceme.org. The students might be interested in interning at EcoPeace. We take interns from all over the world in our offices in Tel Aviv, in Ramallah, or in Amman. There's a sort of a 3-month stay. And then you can work with us on these critical issues of environment, climate, and peace.
Again, thanks so much. And thank Ahmed and campus chaplain Joe Pritchett for proposing the event. Thanks again to Emily for interpreting. And I hope we will see you all at the March 24th Common Hour after spring break. Cosmico, a journey through Latin American music.